Hello and welcome to today's lecture on helical antenna, which is in continuation of the previous lecture. So, in the previous lecture, we saw that helical antennas can operate in three different modes: normal mode, axial mode, and conical radiation pattern mode. But most of the time, third mode is not used. So, mainly normal mode and axial mode antennas are used. So, we started discussion on axial mode. So, today we will continue from the same thing. So, let us start with the previous slide which we had seen. So, this is a simple helical antenna, and we can say that the ground plane size should be at least 0.75 lambda. But let us just see what is really happening here. So, we are actually feeding it over here. I will also mention quickly today about the impedance at this particular point, but let us just see the concept wise. Its power is fed from here, it going from here to here, and then it moves forward. So, if you look at the current here, so current is coming here, and finally, the current becomes equal to 0 at this particular point. Now, when the current is becoming 0 here, part of that will get reflected back. But while all this thing is happening, this antenna is also radiating in the free space over here, because each of the turn here is effective radiator. So, really speaking, what happens, the current which is going through over here, the current which is reflected back, the amplitude of that is really very, very small, because most of that has already radiated. So, the power reflected back from here is relatively small, and hence this particular configuration is also known as traveling wave structure. So, in case of traveling wave, basic idea of traveling wave is that the wave which is being sent here, it is getting out, it is very little is getting reflected back. And in general, traveling wave antennas are broadband antenna, because the reflected waveform is very, very small. So, with this simple concept here, and also just to mention, so if we can wind the wire like this, or we can wind the wire like this here. So, by just interchanging the wire from here to here, we can actually get left hand circularly polarized or right hand circularly polarized antenna. So, we saw the effect of the diameter. There is hardly any effect of the diameter on the performance of the axial mode helical antenna. We saw the support structure, and now we will look at the input impedance. So, since it is a traveling wave structure, it has a fairly large bandwidth, and its resistance is constant over a very large bandwidth. So, if the feed is axial feed, that means if this is the helical axis, which is the axis here, if you feed like this here, then it is known as axial feed. Whereas, if you think about a helix like this, and if you feed along this here, which is peripheral or circumferential feed, that is known as a peripheral or circumferential feed. So, for axial mode, R is approximately given by this particular formula, and for peripheral, R is given by this particular formula. And the beauty of this axial mode helical antenna is that the imaginary part is close to 0, or it has a very small component, and hence it gives broader bandwidth. And if we look at the condition for axial mode is that C lambda should be approximately equal to 1. So, if it is 1, that will give 140 ohm, and if this is 1, that gives about 150 ohm. So, 140, 150, the percentage difference between the two values is not very significant. So, one can actually see that the impedance variation is not too large. However, there are restrictions. So, it is not that this will be valid for any particular case here, but these are valid, these are the restriction that C lambda can be between 0.8 to 1.2. In fact, if you recall, I had shown the mode chart, and where we had shown you that C lambda can vary between 0.8 to 1.2. Alpha angle is required to be between 12 to 14 degree. This condition is mainly there so that we can get good circularly polarized waveform, because what alpha determines? Alpha determines the rise of the helix. Okay, and that gives us the finite value of S for a given value of the diameter. So, this is important, because let us say helix which is rising like this. So, if it is rising like this here, it will have a horizontal and vertical component, and we want these two components should be equal, as well as the phase difference should be 90 degrees. So this condition ensures that. And also the another condition is number of terms should be greater than 4, okay. The reason for that is if you just imagine again a helix here, so at this point current will be 0, so that current will get reflected back. So if the number of turns are very small, then that will come back and affect the performance of the helical antenna. So if at least n equal to 4 turns are there, then the reflected current from the open end from here and coming down over here will be relatively small. So these are the simple condition for which we can get a nearly constant input impedance with reactive part close to 0. However, we can see that this is not really matching with the 50 ohm. So we need to match this impedance with 50 ohm. So for that, there are two different techniques have been used. So input impedance matching technique. So what is done, this is actually very old thing, which is what has been reported earlier. So I'm just telling you that. However, I don't use this technique right now. I use actually the second technique, but let's just see what is the first technique. So you can actually see that this is that helix tubing which is coming up here, and that helix tube which is mostly circular, and that has been actually made flatter. So you flatten the tube and that becomes flat over here, and this is the dielectric sheet which is put in between, and then when this is flattened over here, and that flattened value actually is determined by this particular equation here, just to mention here. So we know that we would like to get a 50 ohm line, epsilon r will be given by the dielectric substrate, h will be the thickness of the substrate, and for this corresponding this Z0 50 ohm, one can calculate what should be the W, and that is how it should be flattened to. And that becomes a very, very difficult thing also, and it's a lot of mechanical work which needs to be done. So I prefer this particular second thing which has been used by several people also. What in this technique is done is that we know that this is the peripheral feed. So we actually, this is of course axial feed here. I'm talking about now when we use this microstrip transition, generally that will be peripheral feed. So let's say this helix tube will come over here. And then generally what is done, we put a dielectric sheet here with the ground plane just like a substrate, and then what you do, you print a microstrip line on this. So on this particular side, microstrip line impedance should correspond to 150 ohm, which is for periphery feed, and in this particular side, the impedance of the thing should be about close to 50 ohm, which is what we would like to feed, and then the coaxial feed can be put like this over here, okay. So what it important is that from here, which is let's say 150 ohm, this is here 50 ohm, then this length is very, very important, okay. So one can use quarter wave transformer, but that is not recommended because a quarter wave transformer will not have a very good impedance bandwidth. So generally what is recommended is use tapered microstrip transition. So from here to here, use a transition from 150 ohm to 50 ohm, and typically this length should be approximately equal to lambda by 2 at the lowest frequency. Then we can get a very good matching. And in fact, we have done this. We used a very low cost substrate over here. So we used FR4 substrate or glass epoxy substrate whose dielectric constant is 4.4, tan delta of course was high, which is 0.02, but since we are using only small portion, that loss was not very significant, and one can use the thickness here which can be 0.8 mm or it can be 1.6 mm depending upon what is available. Now we are going to show you the different radiation pattern. Now this particular study, I just want to tell, it is reported several decades back. Again, the main reason, as I mentioned earlier, the software tools were not there. So people did a lot of experimental work. So they had designed this particular antenna around 400 megahertz. So corresponding to 400 megahertz, you can just say that if we take C lambda 0.97, it can be 1 also approximately. But at this particular thing, so 400 megahertz is equal to 75 centimeter. So 75 divided by pi, so you can say roughly about 25, close to that centimeter is the diameter, okay. So that is fairly large diameter, even though it may look small over here. They had taken n equal to 6, that means 6 turns are there, and they took alpha equal to 14 degree. In fact, I normally recommend, since the circular polarization range is from 12 degree to 14 degree, so I generally recommend take middle value, which is about alpha equal to 13 degree. Nevertheless, they took this value, and now I just want to show the pattern which they had measured. So you can actually see here that what it shows here, horizontally polarized component and vertically polarized component. So solid line is horizontally polarized. So we can see that both horizontally polarized and vertically polarized components are very good, giving rise to very good circular polarization. If you look into here again, the values are fairly close. Even here, the value is pretty close. At this particular thing, when C lambda is about 1.35, or you can think about frequency increase. So basically, the helix remains same. It is just that frequency is being changed. You change the frequency, C lambda changes. So one can see now that there is a deviation between horizontally polarized component and vertically polarized. But one can actually see here for C lambda 0.66 or at a much lower frequency, the two patterns are very, very different. So that is not really a good circularly polarized field here. So one can actually see right from C lambda 0.73 up to about 1.22, one can get good circularly polarized radiation pattern. So it is a very, very simple way to design the helical antenna, but yet they had to do lot of experiments. So these are the experiments which they had done. So here there are 2 turns, 4 turns, 6 turns, 8 turns, 10 turns. Now we know that if number of elements are increased, then the gain will increase, and if the gain increases, beam width will reduce. So one can actually see here, this one has a larger beam width compared to this one here. You can see it has a very narrow beam width. So that means this particular antenna will have a larger gain compared to this particular antenna over here, okay. And then all these things were happening, there were still lot of confusion was there, how to calculate the radiation pattern, why things are happening here. Then later on, simulations were also done. So here are the simulations for single turn. So for single turn, they took an angle alpha equal to 12 degree, n is equal to 1, and you can actually see plane is phi equal to 0, but here this is a phi turn and this is a e theta. So e phi, e theta, which are perpendicular to each other. So now these are the two patterns. Now you can actually see that these two patterns look very different, but however, if you just look into the half power beam width area, if you see in this particular thing, this is where is the axial mode is going to happen. So if it see in this particular region, the two patterns look almost similar to each other. And also, even though this particular turn is there, but this whole thing we will get rid of, especially because of the array factor, because there are number of turns are there. So number of turns will actually ensure that the maximum radiation is in this direction and will have side lobes in this particular direction. So hence this term will be actually negligible. So here this is the approximation made. So this whole pattern was actually approximated to be cos phi, because phi is shown. So cos phi, cos 0 will be 1, and phi is equal to 90 degree or plus minus 90, so field will be 0 over here. And we are not really concerned about the back radiation, because this back radiation will be taken care by putting appropriate ground plane. And then there was a lot of simulation done, lot of measurements were done. So here is a case where axial mode helical antenna actually was fabricated. You can actually see the case studied is C lambda was 0.95, n is 7, alpha is 12 degree. So we know that for this situation, we will get circularly polarized antenna. And for this particular thing, they actually found this to be the measured E theta and E phi average of that, okay. So now this particular thing was obtained. This is nothing but you can actually also think about an end fire array, okay. And now if this is an end fire array, you can think about one element here, second element here, third here, fourth here, fifth here, sixth here, seventh. And from here to here, there is a phase delay. So from here, delay, 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 and that delay condition should be satisfied such a way that it gives us the end fire. Now in the beginning, people were all trying to use the concept of the end fire array. And by using the concept of the end fire array, the results were not matching with this particular configuration. So then they used lot of permutations and combinations, and then they actually, when they use this particular value of phase delay 0.76, which also corresponds to increased directivity condition, and suddenly these two patterns look very, very similar to each other, except for of course there is a not resemblance in the side lobe level. But if you look into this particular thing here, the resemblance is pretty good. So in reality, this axial mode helical antenna is by default an increased directivity end fire array. So they did try to do many things to do the simulation. Ultimately this thing matched very well, and once this particular fact was established, after that all the design equation, all the other things became very straightforward. So we'll start with this thing that yes, helical antenna is a natural increased directivity condition. And I also want to mention here, helical antennas are also known as slow wave structure. So if there is a bend over here, so the phase delay is getting different, and that is why the number 0.76 has been used instead of normal. If we just use increase normal directivity, it would have been equal to 1, but for that the results are very, very different. So this is the condition for the increased directivity. So once this was established, everything else was very, very straightforward. So one can actually now find out by establishing that this is the axial mode helical antenna follows the increased directivity end fire array, then for the increased directivity end fire array, we can actually use straightforward the formula for half power beam width, which is given by this particular expression over here. And then we can also find out what is the beam width between the first null, which is given over here. Now if you take the ratio of the two, that is approximately 2.25. In fact, many books write that half power beam width is about half of this here, or this is 2 times half power beam width. Now I don't agree with that. Generally beam width between the first null is about 2.25 to about 2.29 for majority of the cases which we actually have done the simulation. So after that, finding directivity is very, very easy. So we have already seen the directivity formula, and we know that directivity formula is given by 4 pi divided by theta e theta h, where theta e theta h will be in radian. But I had also mentioned that formula to be used only for smaller arrays. For larger array, we had told you that you use 32,400 divided by theta e theta h, where theta e theta h are in degrees. So looking into this particular thing here, so if you actually take 32,400 divided by half power beam width square, and in this particular case here, we had seen that horizontal and vertical components were exactly same. So half power beam width will be same for both E and H. And since that is same, we put this value over here. So when actually, if you simplify this here, this divided by 52 square comes approximately equal to 12. And this is a square term here, which goes, then this denominator goes up. So C lambda becomes C lambda square. Square root term gets removed, and that is ns lambda. Now at this point, now I differ from the cross book. In the cross book, in general, they have written this as a gain of the antenna. But actually we have found out that is not really the gain, it is actually directivity of this particular antenna. In fact, I also want to mention several papers have been reported later on, and there was a one paper which we noticed that they had done experiments using 5 turn, 10 turn, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, and based on all those number of turns they did the measurement, they did lot of work, and they actually then derived certain approximate formulas for half power beam width, gain and other thing. However, we looked into all of those things also, and what we found out that conventional things which are given by Cross still will work very fine, except for this one small modification that use all of those things as directivity, but gain is given by efficiency multiplied by directivity, and we found that the efficiency is approximately 60%. So, in fact, when we use this particular concept, then our results matched very closely with all those different studies which have been reported. So, actually speaking, if you use this concept, the design of the helical antenna becomes extremely simple. So, hence I still recommend that you can use this, and I can also tell you that majority of the time maximum error in the directivity will not be more than 0.5 dB. So, let us look into now how we can design axial mode helical antenna. So, let us say it is given to us that directivity is equal to 24 dB. Again, this example is given in the Cross book. Only difference is that the Cross book, it is written as gain equal to 24 dB. I have modified that to be directivity equal to 24 dB. So, gain will be actually less. So, if you multiply this number you get it 24 dB corresponds to 251. Just to tell you, if it was 10, this would be 10 dB. If it is 100, this will be 20 dB. If it is 1000, it will be 30 dB. So, that you please remember these some simpler things, how to convert from dB to the numerical value. So, now if you look at the gain of this, you multiply this with 0.6. So, 250 into 0.6 is approximately 150. So, you actually think about you are designing for a gain of 150, correspondingly you can calculate the dB value. But nevertheless, we will go with the directivity equal to 24 dB. So, now we need to do the design. So, we know for axial mode, we can choose the value of C lambda between 0.8 to 1.2. So, in this example, they have chosen as 1.05, but in fact, generally I take the center value which is about 1. Now, alpha can be between 12 to 14 degree. Now, they have taken 12.7, I would generally take about 13 degree, always take the middle path. But anyway, these are the things which are given in that book. So, I am just repeating those. So, here once we know alpha and we know C lambda, you can use this particular figure here. So, we know that from here we can say tan alpha is nothing but S divided by C. So, S is nothing but C lambda into tan alpha. We can multiply C lambda, which is 1.05, tan 12.7 degree. That comes to 0.2366. Now, I want to mention that this entire design is very generic in nature. Everything is normalized with respect to the wavelength. Okay. So, just depending upon whatever is the wavelength, you can choose the values correspondingly. So, for example, let us say you want to design antenna at 1 gigahertz. At 1 gigahertz, lambda will be 30 centimeter. So, then this will be 1.05 multiplied by 30 will be equal to C, and then correspondingly you can find the value of D, which will be C by pi. And then from here we know S lambda is 0.2366. So, S will be equal to this multiplied by lambda, and for 1 gigahertz lambda is 30 centimeter. You multiply this with 30 and then you can calculate the value of S from that. So, now we know that directivity formula is given by this particular value here. So, if we use this expression, what we know directivity which is given. We have chosen C lambda as this value. You can choose 1 also. Now, S lambda has been calculated based on these two chosen value. So, only unknown is n. So, that is now n. N becomes now equal to 80. Now, you can actually see that is too many turns are there. Okay. And if we take too many turns like this here, again think about this. So, total, what will be the total height of the helical antenna? That will be n times s. Okay. So, we can now see 80 times s lambda, which is 0.2366. If you are designing at 1 gigahertz, you have to multiply this with 30, and suddenly you will see that it is a very tall antenna. So, one way is that we can actually design an antenna using 80 turns to realize directivity of 24 dB. Other thing is we can actually use arrays of these helical antenna. So, let us just look at the concept of how we can use this array form. So, here what we are going to look at is a 2 by 2 helical antenna array, which will replace single element this thing. So, instead of using single turn 80 turn helical antenna, one can use 4 20 turn helical antenna. As we know that if we, because the directivity is directly proportional to the number of turns. So, that means if we reduce the turns by 4 times, directivity will be reduced by 4 times. So, directivity of each 20 turn will be now divided by 4 times. So, now we need to put these 4 helical antenna in the form of 2 by 2 array. So, it is now very important that where should we keep these helical antenna? Should we keep them very close to each other, or should we keep them far away? Is there a rule to put these helical antennas at a particular thing? Yes, there is a rule at what spacing these antennas should be put. So, over here we also know that directivity is given by 4 pi a by lambda square. So, directivity is given by 4 pi aperture by lambda square. So, we can find effective aperture by using this formula. We know what is d. We put this value here, that comes approximately 5 lambda square. So, if we assume that this aperture is square, then we can take that as a side length, and that becomes square root 5 lambda. So, this is the value here. So, then if we put these 4 helical antennas at this particular spacing, then that can realize an array. So, we will continue from here. In the next lecture, we will see little bit more detail about what happens if we use different number of elements and if we go for different array sizes, and we will see how we can optimize this and how that aperture is there. And then we will also look at the practical aspects of how to realize and how to design these helical antennas. And after that, we will also talk about normal mode helical antenna. So, with that, we will conclude today's lecture. Thank you. Bye, and we'll see you next time.